All right, welcome back. It is 8:43. Rabbi Shmuley is the author of the newly released book, 10 Conversations You Need to Have with Yourself, A Powerful Plan for Spiritual Growth and Self-Improvement.
When I talk to him, I always feel like I have so much work to do.
Why is it that they had that snooky wig but not the Rabbi Shmuley beard that they were just saying?
Better marketing.
A good commodity.
We'll check into that. All right, so the first thing you say, stop filling your life with junk. Not literal junk. I'm assuming it's junk in your head or something, or is it literal?
Well, I think we're becoming boring people because so much of our conversation is not substantive. It's just about celebrity chatter and gossip like we just had. And that's one of the reasons that when people date, I really think that studies show within 7 minutes they start speaking about a television show or a movie they recently saw. How about speaking about yourself? I think that this book is all about self-awareness. Mm-hmm. It's about understanding what motivates you. It's about understanding your insecurities. I mean, this entire debate that we have going on right now about whether Wall Street is a good thing or whether we should demonize it comes down to the idea of ambition. I mean, at what level do we say ambition is something healthy? At what level do we say that it's crossing a line and it's now encroaching upon other people's freedoms? And yet we don't even try to understand the forces that motivate us personally. We think that everything are these macro forces, and they're not. Societies are built on individuals.
But if you're on a first date and you start talking about your problems instead of snooky, I mean, it could get a little weird there if you get too deep on a first date, right?
Women are really concerned about that.
Yeah.
Women think that they have to be mannequins on dates. They think that men don't want to see a deeper part of themselves. I actually think that it's a very pleasant surprise to a man when he has a woman of real. You just have to be, I mean, most women spend their time preparing for a date by putting on a lot of makeup. What about actually forming an opinion? Reading a newspaper, knowing what's going on in the world to demonstrate that there could be a scintillating connection between the two of you.
All right, quote number two from Rabbi Shmuley, choose love, not attention.
Well, the Michael Jackson Conrad Murray trial is going on right now, and you know, I've been commenting on it because I was close to Michael. This is a perfect example. Michael Jackson was very honest in the book that we wrote together, well, the conversations we recorded for the book, the Michael Jackson tapes, that he was never really given the love that he needed. The net result is that he sought attention, which is really the poor cousin of love. Love is something you get for who you are, and you don't have to earn it. It's a free gift. Attention is something you get for what you do. So it really fosters insecurity because you're always worried about the people around you who are doing the same thing. And Michael, as he approached these concerts, began to feel more and more afraid that he would not compare to his former self. And that's where the drugs came in. That's how he dealt with fear. But the truth is, on a much smaller level, I think we do the same thing. 80% of high school students are asked, what do you want to be when you grow up? And they say famous. They don't care how or what, they just want to be famous, which just shows this phenomenal craving for attention.
And you also say harness your ego for good. How?
Well, I'll tell you, again, we come back to all these demonstrations. I was walking yesterday getting some exercise here in Chicago, and I suddenly found myself engulfed in this demonstration. The people are around me, and it was fascinating. I was telling some of them, by the way, Wall Street's in New York, but that didn't matter. You have to give the ego its due. I know that it's very common among spiritual leaders to say that there should be ego self-effacement and we have to try to deny the pleasures of the body. There has to be balance. You know, the ego is the part of us that wants to make something of ourselves. Everybody wants to be a somebody. Nobody wants to be a nobody. Everything in balance. But just to say that we should not be motivated professionally, I'm actually a great believer that far more important than food, clothing, and shelter is human dignity. We all want to lead a life where we feel that we're self-reliant and that there's a level of independence. That doesn't mean the government should not be involved when we really need government to be involved. But by and large, give the ego its due. Stop saying that you're a bad person if you work hard and you want to achieve things.
All right. Next tip is see past your defense mechanisms.
Yeah, that's the hardest of all. I think that we learn a lot from our friends. Believe it or not, we learn even more from our critics, but we're not prepared to hear what they have to say because we have these walls. And I think that in an age where we are very insecure, and insecurity seems to motivate a lot of what we do, the defense mechanisms are all around us. Now, how can you really grow as a person and become the person that you want to be? Because this entire book, again, is about self-awareness. It's about having a vision for your life. How can that happen if you're not prepared to hear from people when you make errors, when you make mistakes? I actually think by the age of 40, 50, we begin to stagnate and the growth stops. And that's where we begin to veg in front of Monday Night Football. I know there was a big game last night. I'm sorry, Bears. But that's where there's this cessation of our self-development. And that's a shame because life is not, it doesn't end at 40. You know, there's a new study that actually shows that people go into a trough at 40, 42. Mm-hmm. I'm 44 right now. I've been in that trough since I was 20. So,
But what if you're out dating for the first time again at that age and you're stuck in this rut and you say you're the same person, there's no way to change?
Be a different person. Don't date the way you did when you were 20 and 30s. Don't make it just about the physical. don't be afraid to be yourself. Be very natural. Actually, studies show that the sexiest quality for a woman in a man's eyes, it's not her appearance. It's her self-confidence. It's how she carries herself. It's just that we're all so afraid to be ourselves because we think we're not good enough. I think the greatest problem plaguing America today is a permanent sense of inadequacy. I mean, take women, for example. They're made to feel always that they're not young enough, not thin enough, that their legs aren't long enough, their chests aren't big enough, their eyes aren't bright enough. And as you walk around feeling not enough, not enough, not enough, we use this all, we use forms of compensation. For men, the compensation are the bells and whistles of success. You know, hey, look at the car that I drive. Don't look at me. Look at this hunk of metal that comes with me. But people see through it after a while. I'm hoping that this book will make us a little bit more comfortable in our own skin and give us a sense of adequacy.
All right, Rabbi Shmuley, thank you for joining us. The book, again, 10 Conversations You Need to Have with Yourself.
Or you need to have with yourself, Larry.
A powerful plan for spiritual growth.
You're not crazy if you talk to yourself. It's a good thing.
I talk to myself quite a bit when I walk off this set at 9 o'clock.
Rabbi Shmuley, great to see you again.
Thank you, Robin. Thank you, Larry.
Hey, Jim.